This is the Rachel Finan teleconference for PR Collaborative for Wednesday, September 19th, 2012 at 1:30 p.m. Central Time. Excuse me, everyone. We now have our speakers in conference. Please be aware that each of your lines is currently in a listen-only mode. At the conclusion of the presentation, we will open the floor for questions, and at that time, instructions will be given if you would like to ask a question. I would now like to turn today's conference over to Patrick Holden.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Patrick Holden. I'm Chief Executive of the Sustainable Food Trust, and we have played a coordinating role in helping to communicate the results of this very important research program as widely as possible, since we think it's essential that we harness the power of public opinion to drive the changes that are needed to our food system. And I am now delighted to introduce you the person who is responsible for this research, Professor Gilles-Éric Seralini from the University of Caen. And I should say before asking him to speak, and he is proposing to speak for about 10 minutes, that he has had a very busy day fielding calls and media interviews from all over the world. So we are grateful to you, Professor Seralini, for spending this time with this very important gathering of media representatives from all over the USA.
So thank you very much.
Thank you. Over to you.
Okay. So, good day, everybody. I'm happy to speak to you from France, Paris. In fact, I am professor of molecular biology in the University of Caen in Normandy in France. And I was an expert for the government, for the French government during 9 years, and then for the European government for assessing GMOs, food and feed GMOs, but also genetic therapy and other things. But also I am a researcher and I'm leading a group on the effects of the main pollutants on health. I am working with human cells, with embryonic cells without embryo destruction, and with placental cells, hepatocytes, and we had previously demonstrated the effects of Roundup, the main pesticide of the world, which is also an herbicide. We have demonstrated the deleterious effect of this pesticide on human cells at very low dose, like 100,000 dilutions from the compound you have in the bottle in the store. So these are levels that are usually in water, in food and feed. And what we have done in this very long study, this took me 5 years of my life, together with CREGEN, which is an organization in Europe for more expertise on GMOs, pesticides and pollutants. And what we have performed is a lifelong rodent experiment with two kind of compounds. The main GMO maize tolerant to Roundup, the main GM maize tolerant to Roundup, or GM corn, which is called, the code name is NK603, and we also tested Roundup by itself in order to know if the potential toxicity was due to Roundup or to the GM maize itself. So what we have set up is an experiment 2 years long. This was the longest and the most detailed experiment ever published on not only a GMO but also a pesticide in the world, because the other experiments on pesticides in vivo with a lot number of animals are generally performed with the so-called active principle alone. That means one chemical compound called glyphosate in this case, one chemical compound out of the main herbicide of the world. And now we have tested in this in this experiment the Roundup in formulation. That means like it is in nature, in the fields, when it is spread. So we have tested that at 3 doses. This was the first kind of treatment with a pesticide alone. 3 doses, they are 0.1 ppb, so a part per billion, which is very low. It's the usual contaminating level of the tap water. and then 400 ppm, which is the level of residues of glyphosate authorized in US in some GMOs, because you must know first that 100% of agricultural edible GMOs are pesticide plants. That means plants designed to contain a pesticide because they tolerate it, like the Roundup Ready soya or the Roundup Ready maize that we are testing, or the Roundup Ready oilseed rape, etc. And we have tested the second dose, which was the dose containing the residues usually admitted in GMOs. And then we have tested the third dose of Roundup, which is the dose which is half of an agricultural dilution spread on the field by the agricultural worker, which was the highest dose for us. And then we have tested again two other treatments. So the GMO alone, the GMO which was not treated by Roundup in the field, and then we have tested the GMO treated with Roundup during the field. And this was to answer the question, if there is any potential toxicity, is this due to the Roundup, to the GMO alone, or both? And we have tested 100 males and 100 females, adult animals. We shouldn't forget that the rat is the usual surrogate model in order to test all the chemicals, including drugs, etc. And only medicinal drugs then go to clinical trials. But all the other compounds, like pesticides and pollutants, are tested on rats before being released in the commercial, economical system. So what we have done is three doses of transgenic corn, either treated or not with Roundup, if you have followed. And then we have three doses, 11% in the diet, in an equilibrated diet. It was necessary because it was a lifelong experiment. So during the lifespan of the rat, it has to eat equilibrated diet. And then this is around the level that the American population may eat because the GMO residues are not labeled, unfortunately, and this is, in my opinion, a very severe problem, because in Europe we have this labeling, and that helps us to avoid these compounds if necessary. Then, and to promote our personal choices, and thus our freedom. Then we have the 22% level, which is the double of that, but still some people, when they eat a meal with corn, I mean, you have more than 22% in the meal maybe, and 33%, which is the highest level. So this is, it is also the first time that we do three doses, because the industry usually makes two doses. And for instance, the NK603 maize was tested by Monsanto only during 3 months in order to obtain the authorizations to release that in the fields and in the food and the feed. So the results were really alarming. And we have followed that in a great detailed manner. That means we have measured 100 parameters per rat, and about 50 parameters have been followed 11 times during the 2 years. Never ever the companies have done that, and I think it's even bizarre and really problematic for us that the U.S. government or any other Californian government or other has requested. It is abnormal that they have not requested to make a serious test before releasing that in the environment, because they are really, these GMOs are really pesticide sponges, and we do not discover in the States that pesticides may have some side effects on human health or on mammalian health in general. So we have seen after 4 months, And this is very important because you don't forget that the regulatory test lasted only 3 months by the companies. We have discovered that the tumors began, mostly mammary tumors, but we had some kidney tumors also. The mammary tumors were mostly in females. In fact, 93% of the tumors were mammary, at the level of the mammary gland. And then after 1 year, there was a real increasing of the number of tumors, and this was up to almost every rat having two or three tumors for the female rats for the lowest doses of Roundup. So surprisingly, the pathologies were almost the same in comparison to control. So they were sex-specific or monodependent because the sexual hormones were disturbed, but also numerous biochemical parameters indicating a leakage of the kidney function, very big severe nephropathies, it's called like that. And we had the observation of, after 1 year, hepatorenal toxicities, which are really deleterious and damaging for the rat, and the rat died. And the mammary tumors were also numerous. So there was no real difference between the effects observed during the three doses, so that means that the threshold was reached and at the first dose, and this is in comparison to control always, to control that we're eating the same genetic maize but not genetically modified. So it's called the isogenic, non-transgenic maize. And we had these effects very surprising because we understood the effects with the Roundup because we had demonstrated previously and others that it is an endocrine disruptor on cells and that it can have mutagenic effects. But not the glyphosate alone, but when it is mixed with adjuvants and other compounds that are present to help the product to penetrate the plant cells, or when it is an insecticide, there are also these adjuvants to help to penetrate the insect cells, but it also helps to penetrate the mammalian cells and the human cells. We have demonstrated that. Thus, the Roundup is a lot more toxic than glyphosate, around at least 100 times, depending on the conditions, up to more. We understand that the mammalian tumors and the hepatorenal toxicities in the males because of these residues, and we had the molecular explanations, that means the detailed explanations in cells. Well, I can answer to the details afterwards. And you can see anyway on the CREGEN website all the details in English, in French, and in Spanish. So it's CREGEN, and in the website of the journal, which is Food and Chemical Toxicology, which is the best journal, scientific peer-reviewed paper of food toxicology in the world. And in fact, Monsanto, the company making this maize, had already written in this journal previously some opinions, and this journal was quite in favor of GM technology in general, so it was really difficult to publish there, but we did it because it was a unique and a very detailed and longest protocol in the world. So then we had the groups with the GMO treated with Roundup, and then we said, well, if there are residues of Roundup too in this food because of the GMO, because in fact the GMO was modified in order to tolerate the Roundup, so it is normal that we have the same explanations. And we saw on the slides the hepatocytes disturbed, like when we were putting in vitro the Roundup on hepatocytes. So we had several confirmations that the Roundup residues were reacting. However, this was not in fact avoiding the hypothesis that other toxic compounds in the GM were acting. So we were really interested by the results of the GMO alone that was not treated with Roundup and at the same concentrations that the GMO treated with Roundup. These were other groups. And the groups with the GMO alone, surprisingly, had also hormonal disruptions. The sex balance was disturbed, and there were also mammary tumors and hepatorenal toxicities. First, we know that the liver and the kidneys are detoxification organs reacting to chronic chemical intoxication. But then we didn't explain first what happened. So we went through the detailed analysis of the diet, more than the analysis of the chemical composition usually performed when the so-called substantial equivalence to an isogenic counterpart is done. So that means that usually the chemical composition of the diet is made, but not very detailed. And we detailed a lot this composition, and we found that some protective compounds, which are called ferulic acid and caffeic acid, which are in a lot of plants to protect against, they are known in the literature, the scientific literature, to protect against mammary tumors or hepatic problems. These compounds were reduced up to 51% in the diet. So, and we wanted then the link between these compounds that were disrupted, that were lowered, and the transgenic modification. And we found that the enzyme, which is expressed, overexpressed in 80% of GMOs, well, I can answer afterwards for the details what enzyme, but when you modify the plant, you make the plant overexpress a new enzyme, which is characteristic of the GMO, and this enzyme is designed to help the protein synthesis. But with some compounds that have molecules that have cycles in their structures. And in fact, the caffeic and ferulic acid had cycles in the structure. So we understood that it was an indirect metabolism due to the overexpression of the transgene in the plant, but because the transgene was made to render the plant insensitive to glyphosate. And this was the new discovery that we had explaining why these kind of GMOs are really problematic and can give crucial problems like mammary tumors or toxicities at the level of kidney and liver. Now I will conclude saying first, what can we deduce from that, and is it important in comparison to human health? I would like to say first that, the rat is a surrogate model, but to understanding the molecular mechanism helped us to say that we can make parallels with the human health, and also because we have the same molecular mechanism in human cells. We have demonstrated that in the lab for the Roundup residues. Thus, the consequences for us is to forbid this kind of GMOs that are representing 80% of the GMOs in the world, including the transgenic Roundup Ready soya, because there is the same transgene and the same characteristic to contain Roundup. And also the BT oilseed rape tolerant to Roundup. And we want to forbid that, and we also want to extend the tests that have been performed by the companies up to 2 years and not only 3 months. Well, we think it's a criminal system if there is lax in this kind of assessment, because do you imagine that 200 or 400 million people in your continent and you have also 450 million Europeans, and you have in fact billions of people in the world that could eat a lifelong during a life these kind of products, and nobody in the world, even the science in US, was ever able to render mandatory long-term test on rats. So we are taken as guinea pigs, and that's completely abnormal. Moreover, you don't even have labeling in the States, and you are very isolated in this thinking, because you know that 150 countries in the world have signed the so-called Cartagena Protocol that obliged to recognize the GMOs at least at the borders of the country, and only the states and some countries in North America, depending on the state economy, didn't want to do that, and I think it is a shame. Then, but I respect American people. This is not against the American people, but I think only a few American people know all these details, but the administration in the States is in fact monitoring that. I was expert also in the WTO conflict between Europe and the States, and I heard I was hearing the arguments between both groups of countries in order to say there is a labeling or no labeling, and I think that the arguments saying there is no labeling are quite ununderstandable to our point of view, because you know, you modify something, it's the first time in the history of life that one species is able to modify the hereditary patrimony of other living species, and we do that at an industrial speed. We may have some metabolic consequences like the ones that we are evidencing, and nobody has requested more than 3 months test, and nobody even requested in the States, well, except the organic agricultures and other people, but in general the population didn't request to know where they are, or only a few people advised people, I mean, it's a first step in order to prevent risk, to know where are the things. I mean, you cannot speed up on the highway without knowing where are the other cars, because you're sure to have an accident. So the last thing is that we are asking for the transparency. So that means that it is unbelievable that only the companies do these tests for the government and or for the agencies, and they are not even obliged to show the blood analysis of the rats that allowed them to authorize these maize before. And we are showing that now during 2 years. But they were not obliged to show what they had done during 3 months, because we had to fight with them in court with Monsanto to have the first data during 3 months. And we published that they were indicating some hepatorenal toxicity signs, and this is why we wanted to extend the test in order to understand if these first signs were giving real pathologies, and it is the case. So I think that today the world is changing. I had on the phone a lot of countries and a lot of journalists, and they realize that they have been hostages, they have been guinea pigs, because they didn't even know where are the GMOs in the food of the feed, and they didn't even know that they were tested in short times, and they didn't have requested the blood analysis of the animals that have allowed to authorize that. So I think the world has to change if we want to really have a secure food and to have some health. You know, and to finish, my last sentence will be, I made lectures in about 30 countries on 5 continents, and I every time ask to the people, do you have some chronic pathologies in your family, in the people you love? And everybody has a person in his close friends or relatives or family that has a cancer, a hormonal problem, a hormonal disease, a nervous disease, an immune defect. All these things are not explained by medicine, by new viruses or new bacteria in general. They are not explained by a genetic shift in the human population within 10 years, because all that has been exploding within, let's say, a couple of decades. And And still, we don't know where it comes from. It comes from the environment. But if you imagine that all GMOs and pesticides have been assessed like that, that means that a lot of chemical products, and I know that as an expert for governments, have been assessed like that, really in a lax manner. So we wanted to give an example with the GMO and pesticides, but I think that all chemicals that enter in the food and feed, like plasticizers and other pollutants, should be assessed on health on the long term, because we are all impregnated with these compounds in our bodies. So this is an example, and I hope that other groups, other scientific groups, will follow that, and that the population will follow that in order to request mandatory tests in general, and to request the transparency on what has done and what has been done for now. And I think that this will change the world. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Seralini, for that.
Was it clear in my English? I'm sorry.
Your English is fine, and I hope that everyone was getting it, because I certainly was. Thank you for that very comprehensive summary of the research protocols and the main outcomes, which I would say presents an overwhelming case for further research, and indeed, as you've just been describing, an urgent need for reform of the regulatory system as well as the labelling issue. Now, we also have with us Dr. Michael Antoniou, but unless he wants urgently to say something, in view of time constraints, what I would now suggest is that we open the floor for questions to you, Professor Seralini, from some of the representatives from the media who are present on this call.
No,
Michael, do you have anything to say?
No, I would, apart from endorsing everything that Professor Seralini has said about the need for this kind of work, I just want to really thank him, congratulate him and thank him for doing this work, because he's basically plugged a huge hole in the evaluation of GMOs and herbicide formulations. And for me, the results are really quite shocking, and regulators need to sit up and take note of this and take all necessary steps to protect the safety of people.
Thank you.
But thank you.
Go on now.
Thank you. At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we will open the floor for questions. If you would like to ask a question, simply press the star key followed by the one key. That's star one on your touch-tone phone now. Questions will be taken in the order in which they're received, and if at any time you would like to remove yourself from the queue, just dial star two. Again, that's star one to pose a question. Our first question comes from Andrew Refkin from the New York Times.
Thanks for holding the call, and thanks for doing the research.
Thank you.
There have been some questions already coming in about the some of the choices you made in the research, one being that this breed of rat is basically seriously prone toward tumors, that after 2 years it would be remarkable if they had not developed tumors. And that, so the pictures seem to be a funny thing to be stressing. That's what some scientists are saying. This is separate from the overall issue of transparency and, you know, again, the importance of this kind of work.
Yeah, of course, you're right, but you imagine that this is a very common question, and that a big toxicological journal wouldn't let publish. This is the best food toxicology journal, which is in fact American, in the world. So you imagine that we know all of these problems, and that what I said was always a comparison with the controls. So it's the over number of tumors and the over number of pathologies towards the controls. And in fact, if you look at our paper, of course, the controls are some pathologies by the end of the life, and we have a gray zone where we have considered that all the pathologies were due to aging, and we have excluded that gray zone, and I was talking about the difference during the kind of healthy life of the system, of the controls, during the whole experiment. So be confident that it was a comparison between the controls and that the referees of the journal have seen that first.
Great, thank you.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Tom Philpott from Mother Jones Magazine.
Hi. Again, I'd like to thank you for the research. And I would like to raise a question that was raised to me by a scientist that I ran this by, and that is that it doesn't look like I understand that you measure the food and water intake, but the values aren't reported in the study. And they also, the body weight changes aren't reported. And so the question raised is, might there have been differences in food and water intake that could explain some of the differences in tumor development and kidney function?
This is a good question. In fact, you have seen that we had no room. It is the longest and the most detailed study that has ever been done. So we cannot put all in one paper. We think to publish about 5 papers out of this study concerning the difference between all organs. So we have kept some things. Of course, for the highest dose of Roundup only, there is animals drink less, but this was the only case where there was a difference on the long time, because the rats do not detect 0.1 ppb of Roundup in the drinking water, and they didn't eat or drink less in general. And moreover, when there is in food maize or at 11%, it's an equilibrated diet, so they didn't really feel any difference. We have tested also the behavior and the nervous system of the rats, etc., and there was no difference. So the only difference was at the highest dose of the subagricultural dose of Roundup, which was kind of our positive control. We do not deduce too much from that. And then the rats were less drinking, but for the males there was also this. But surprisingly, all the rats were living longer because they had a little bit less weight, and they became more resistant to the pathology that developed. And but in general, all the conclusions I gave are standard in comparison to the body weight, and all the rats were increasing in the same manner, etc. There were no really specific results to publish in the first crucial paper at this level, but we will publish all the growth of all the organs. We have checked 34 organs. And whatever is the first explanation, for instance, you give maize and some treated rats eat less or have renal problems, whatever is the first explanation, then it is always due to the diet or to the or to the water. And so the things that we have cannot be explained by only a different taste from the food, because this was not visible in the behavior of the rats. And for the drinking water, it's really not detectable at 0.1 ppb. I mean, we are all drinking water contaminated with these levels, but we are not monitored for that, and all the other parameters are varying from person to person, so we cannot deduce anything, and it's difficult to have epidemiological studies at these levels. So this was not the first reason, and this was not the reason for all treated groups except the group drinking the highest dose of Roundup. This was not the reason of the renal pathologies, because we always compare that to the controls.
Professor Seralini, if I may just intervene, I'm aware that some of the people on this call may have limited time. Are you able to stay on the call and answer more questions to a certain deadline, Professor Seralini? And if so, what is that? Because I just want people to know how long the call is going to last.
I don't know. I mean, again, 10 minutes or something like that?
Well, that would be fine. I'm sure there are lots of questions queuing up, so I shall give way. But perhaps we need to keep the questions and particularly the answers tight in order to get them.
Yeah, you have to know that we have a list of questions already present in our website, and that you get at yours, and we will answer to that too. So that can continue by mail afterwards.
Well, perhaps if there is a question which is referred to, which is already answered, you can mention that to keep the answers nice and tight.
Yeah, okay. I will try to make my answers short.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Elizabeth Weiss from USA Today.
Hi, thanks so much for taking my call. In looking at other research, although there haven't been long-term studies of glyphosate-tolerant corn fed to rats, there have been very long studies in soybeans, and they don't appear to have found any of these large tumors or the high mortality rates are much different at all. So I'm wondering, why would soybeans be different than corn?
Well, it's a good question, but as you may know, we have reviewed all these papers in detail, in great detail, and the longest and the most serious that have been being studied in the soy were the Malatesta studies that were performed with the Roundup Ready transgenic soy, and they have published hepatic and other organ problems like kidney problems and in the testes, in the pancreas, due to the Roundup residues. They have even been able, but that was only during 8 months, and they studied only microscopy. And yes, there were some signs, but once again, there was, even with the transgenic soy, I mean, you have authorized in the state the transgenic soy without having some mandatory tests with the transgenic soy on rats or on other mammals. This was lacking in the first in the first row, and then Monsanto and others have made some 3 month tests, but the longest tests during 2 years are lacking a lot of biochemical issues and a lot of tumors analysis, etc. And so there was no so much detailed study before on that. So we cannot really say that that there are no problems with the soy. We do think the contrary, and we would like to make and we would like to make the studies on soy too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Elizabeth Grossman from The Pump Handle.
Thanks for taking my question. Your study focused on the effects of ingesting either the chemical or food with residues. I was wondering if any similar effects have been seen through other routes of exposure and what implications your study might have for agricultural workers or other people who are using this chemical and might be exposed through other routes apart from eating food with the chemical.
Well, unfortunately, what I said is that it is not only the longest and the most detailed study on the GMO, but it is also the longest and the most study and the most detailed study on a pesticide in the world. So that means that when pesticides are tested during 2 years, there are some studies like that, but it is the active principle alone and not the pesticide like the agricultural worker is using. However, with the bisphenol A or other pesticides or compounds, you also have these kind of things like hormonal-dependent pathologies creating toxicities of the liver and the kidney. But once again, we have only, at this level, only companies test. And the exact, the precise results are kept confidential, but there are some researchers in the world that have found such and such side effect and published part of the system, and this is why we cannot have a comprehensive answer about your question, but we are sure that there can be some compounds that can give some hormonal-dependent pathologies like that at low levels, like most endocrine disruptors. And we discovered that Roundup is an endocrine disruptor too.
Thank you.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Jack Kasky from Bloomberg News.
Yeah, hi, thanks for taking my question. I'm wondering why you didn't disclose the results of the control group in your charts and photos so we could easily compare the controls to the, especially with the charts, the controls to your GMO fed rats. And also I'm wondering how statistically significant it would be for, say, I think it's 3 in 10 of the controls died versus maybe 5 in 10 for some of the male groups. What's the significance of that? And I also understand that maybe some of these GMO groups fared actually better and some of the controls, but none of this detail is disclosed. Can you fill me in?
Yeah. If I'm sure to understand your question, the first part is why didn't we put photos of normal control rats?
The charts of the controls and, the photos as well.
Because most of them, you see, for the tumors of males, there was only one tumor by the end of the experiment, but they just look like rats. And this is why any photo of rat is okay. Well, you just remove the tumor and you have the photo of the rat. So there was no point to show. We showed what were the tumors and what were the number of tumors. Then the second part of the question was it statistically different? Is that right? Hello?
Sir, his line is back in main conference.
Okay. So the question was, what was the statistical difference?
Yes, and he mentioned the deaths in particular, comparison.
Well, as you can see, it is really difficult to say that the statistics today are not significant when you have a 5 to 6 times difference or 500% to 600%. It is true that it is not for whole groups, and it is true that it is not during the whole life. This is why we use a very detailed statistical analysis with the biochemical parameters in order to know if this was confirming the pathologies. And we use statistics that are characteristic, for instance, of a high number of values in order to do these studies, the so-called OPLSDA, and then we saw the statistical difference at the biochemical levels. But at the mortality, for the mortality rate tumor rate, there is no real way to make variation curves that could fit the model of nonlinear effects where you have also more tumors by the end of the life due to aging, like I said. So, of course, there are punctual differences where there are very high difference, 2 to 5 times more, and then there are also positions where there are no difference by the end of the life. You can see that on the curves. But we didn't want to make punctual statistical in the old system, because this has not been judged as performance by the agencies today in the world. So this is why we prefer to have multiple variable analysis like the genomic method, what we published in the paper. But when we had a great number of variable.
Thank you. I just would like to mention that these questions came up in London today, questioning the statistical analysis, and I think there are different opinions about that, and that was said by one of the professors who was commenting on this, and actually he said the differences are so dramatic that in a way, whichever statistical approach you take, you can't ignore the differences.
Well, when you are human, you don't want to be in the group where you have 6 times more tumors anyway.
So could we move to our next?
Thank you. We have a follow-up now from Jack Caskey from Bloomberg News.
That was fast. I was just trying to repeat the question. I'll pass.
I'm sorry?
I just asked my question.
Oh, okay. So.
Very good, sir. We have one final question from Adam Eidinger from Midwood Media.
I just want to get your reaction to the criticism that this study is on a statistical fishing trip, I think is the word that was used by one researcher. It's kind of rhetorical, but what do you have to say to that?
Come again? There was a fishing method made by a researcher, but what?
A researcher looking at the study says it's a quote statistical fishing trip, that you were looking statistically. It's not. It's looking for things that are not there. Is basically what they're trying to say. So, can you just respond to that concisely?
Yes, I just answered to that question, I think, and there is those questions are detailed on the website. I think that when you have 2 to 5 times more tumors in the treated groups, there is no need of multiple variable analysis like we have done for the biochemical data. And the tumors were there anymore, and we had like discrete data that were very precise, and the mortality was, well, when you say that the first rat was dying 600 days before the first control, the first treated rat was dying 600 days before the first control, you can see the space between the curves showing that there is an over mortality and an over number of tumors in the study, and this is, and their pathologies are confirmed, of course, statistically in comparison to the controls by the most modern statistical methods that were ever used. So, and then we have the histology and we have the electronic microscopy. So we have crossed things, and the statistic is not always helping for interpretation. The old systems with the p-values, etc., they are not adapted for this kind of data.
Thank you very much. Are there any further questions?
Yes, sir. We have a question from Andy Pollack from New York Times.
Yes, hi. Perhaps this was asked before, but looking at the data, particularly for the mortality and the tumors, there doesn't seem to be a dose response. And in some cases, the highest GMO dose and the highest round of dose actually do better than the control group. I'm wondering if that undermines any concern that there's an effect here. And if there's a sort of a threshold level, what's the evidence that there is, you know, a threshold that would explain this?
Well, it's a good question, sir, because there are two kinds of toxicity. One is like a poison on a short term, where the dose effect, when you say a dose effect, there is always a dose effect, but a linear dose effect increasing with the dose is expected. For instance, when you are exposed to very well-known chemical toxic compound at high dose, like venom or cyanide bromide, sorry for the pronunciation, etc. But when you have a normal pathology, the nonlinear effects are the rule. For instance, when you have a small quantity in a female body, in a woman, when you have a small quantity of estradiol, you have ovulation, you have a positive effect on the ovary. When you have more, you stop the ovulation, you block the ovulation, and you have the contrary. So what we evidenced in this work, and we can say that not only looking at the mortality and the tumors, but also on the biochemical parameters and on the histology, is that it was a hormone-dependent effect. And this hormone-dependent effect was clearly demonstrated by the statistical analysis of the biochemical data. And when you have a hormone-dependent effect, I am a molecular endocrinologist at first, and when you have a hormone-dependent effect, you have no linear effect in general, but curves effect, like U or G curves. And we are in this complex system there, where the roundup disturbs the hormones and disturbs the receptors, and then you have a feedback control mechanism, and then you have the beginning, for instance, of a cancer. So when persons develop a cancer during their life, it's a system by successive salves or curves, and it's not linear increasing of the tumor. You have regression, stops, and it increases again, and also in the pathologies, the hormone-dependent pathologies in general. So our result was to see that we were in this sort of case and not on the linear toxicology. And because the linear toxicology, the old system that doesn't take into account the endocrine disrupting mechanism, was always waiting for linear effects, otherwise they discredit the effects. This is why we went aside. We didn't see a lot of pathologies due to things in the regulatory test. So we shouldn't wait at first a linear dose effect for any toxic compound. But the chronic toxicity has more chance to be non-linear in you or jiggers, like it is admitted today in endocrinology, than in a linear effect. So it is not like a poison, but a disturbance of your hormones and your biochemical system. Mm-hmm. With the regulation and the reaction of the body, and then another problem, and then the body reacts less and less, and this drives to pathology. This is a mechanism that we have evidenced.
Thank you, and I think it would be fair to say that just on that point, apart from the need to replicate these results with further research, more research is needed to explore the hypothesis that Professor Cerellini already has some evidence to demonstrate, but more would be useful.
Well, yes, we would like to do several things. First, we would like to do, of course, like the project we have, to do genomic and transcriptomic analysis in order to know what were the genes disturbed, and this is very important, what were exactly the mechanisms to see what happened. And the second thing is, of course, to replicate that maybe on this GMO, but also on other GMOs, and also to have transgenerational studies. This is very important because my guess is that the babies and the fetuses will be differently sensitive than the adults, of course, and that could give some transgenerational effect. So we would like to have these kind of studies to be done in order to answer more precisely to these interesting questions.
Thank you. Are there any other further questions?
Well, sir, that was our final question. I thank the audience for your questions. Turn the call back over to you, sir.
Well, I would like to end by thanking everyone for coming on the call and for your patience in staying on the call for an hour. And I would like to thank Professor Cerellini for his comprehensive summary of not only of the nature of the trials but also the outcomes, and for your very important questions. And all I would like to end by saying is that it seems to me that your role in communicating the information that has been discussed in this call and, of course, is contained in the report and on the CREGEN website as widely as possible will be critical if we are to bring about the changes that it would seem to me from the evidence that we've heard are needed both in the regulatory system and in commissioning of further research. Not only replicate the results if that can be achieved, but also to explore in more detail the mechanistic causes of the negative health outcomes.
Yeah, and we shouldn't forget that the shame is that university researchers were obliged to do that on a product commercialized during 15 years already in the States, and that nobody did that before. This is a real shame for us.
Yes. And just Dr. Antonio, do you want to, one word just to, in case you've got something you think needs to be said that hasn't been covered?
No, I think everything has been covered very comprehensively, and I just hope everybody really takes on board the magnitude of this work and so that the system changes that are required that have been mentioned can be expedited for the safety of people and the environment.
Well, I think this is a good way to conclude the discussion. I would thank you very much all for your participation in this call, and good afternoon and good evening. And do please make contact with the Sustainable Food Trust or CREGEN, Professor Cerellini, if you need to follow any of these issues up on their website and through our website as well.
Thank you very much. Have a good night now.
Yep.
Thank you. This does conclude our teleconference for the day. You may now disconnect.